flipping that crack, trying to get back. Nigga, I'm so South Philly, nigga. Shout out my North Philly niggas. Popping them purse, sipping that lean. Fuck around, you get lined. It's just me and my team. Pussy, I'm so South Philly, nigga. So South Philly, nigga. Southwest, West Philly, nigga. Most of my days up in the kitchen. Pyrex whipping, dropping that fish. 20 grand on my wrist. And I ain't even got no ice in my shit. I've been the man with the bricks, that's why I'm popping my shit. You strap, we strap. I've been the man serving crack in the lack. Listen to Beanie Mac. Got these niggas upset, cause I'm up next. Get the 40 on my head, that's why I walk with a limp. And now I'm polo for the law, too. I toss all my shit. And you don't live how I live, you can't walk in my mix. I go hard out here, I did time for this shit. And all you fuck niggas telling I ain't liking that shit. I'm from the hood with niggas busting all max. Young niggas flipping that crack, trying to get back. Nigga, I'm so South Philly, nigga. Shout out my North Philly niggas. Popping them purse, sipping that lean. Fuck around, you get lined. It's just me and my team. Pussy, I'm so South Philly, nigga. Southwest, West Philly, nigga.
If it's about action, I'ma send something. I don't rap beef, just that'll lead me to bend something. Handgun a machine, I'ma extend something. Get tag, I shit bag, go out the pin something. The cat man.
Good afternoon, everybody. We are back to Big Ben Campus, and we are live Thursday, February 2nd, 2017. My name is Jeff. They call me the Big Ben Campus here with my co-host Ryan. Ryan, how you doing today?
Doing well, man. How are you?
Doing well. Shout out to O'Malley. That's Meek Mill's boy right there, right?
Okay. Yeah, never heard of him.
Yeah. Cree Fort, South Philly. That's an ode to South Philly, Ryan. I'm feeling very... I feel like I want to be in South Philly right now.
All right.
I don't know why. This weather gets me, like, you get excited at times sometimes because you think, you know, it's great about winter. You know, it's cool. You got cold weather, but you got summer on the horizon, you know?
Yep. Yeah, we're already in February, so I mean, and it's been a mild winter, so we've been pretty fortunate. So hopefully it stays that way, and like you said, spring and then summer will be here before we know.
Shout out to my grandma, Ryan. She's 91 today.
Oh, wow. Nice.
I talked to her today, and, you know, I never thought about this, but on my mom's side of the family, there's literally five or six people that are 90 years old.
Wow.
My great-grandpa was 104 when he died.
So, oh, when he died.
Yeah, okay. So I'm thinking of, like, gene-wise, I get decent That's genes on good. That side, you know?
Yep.
But yeah, welcome to everyone out there listening. It's Groundhog Day, I guess you could call it.
Gosh. is there any more, like, stupid day?
It's for fun, you know? It's kind of a wives' tale.
I always thought it was kind of lame, personally. But well, I mean, a groundhog predicting the weather? I mean,
it's just, you know, they used to do it back in the day, I guess.
No, I get it.
You know, it's a very much a police holiday. I know the police lodges around here, they all get together for that. And, you know, who's O'Malley? Yeah, he's a rapper. He's a Philly rapper. Welcome to everyone out there listening. As always, we're back. Ryan, we tried something different yesterday. Well, I tried something different yesterday, and I gave out a pick for every game other than the member plays.
Right.
Which, by the way, went 3-0 last night. But Ryan, so I tallied everything up, and I hit 19 out of 32. It's pretty good. 59%.
Sure.
I picked every game.
Yep.
So, I mean, on the year now, and that's what's cool about doing big cards, because if you do well, your record goes up high.
Yeah.
But if you lose, it's bad too.
Right.
I'm going to do it again tonight.
All right.
We're going to rapid fire all the games. I will skip several due to having plays on them. But we'll do that. We'll talk Super Bowl. I will give out my play for the Super Bowl. I figure I'm just going to give it off, you know.
Yeah, it's one game.
Yeah.
You know?
Prop list, though, will be emailed to all my customers, and we'll be jamming them down the bookie's throat this weekend. You have your play of the day. You hit last night. Congrats.
Thank you.
St. John's, which they were a member play of mine as well. Great spot for the Johnnies.
It was.
And they, get the job done easily.
Very easily. So, yeah, it was nice. They, you know, really like, took it to that. You know, we talked about on my breakdown. I talked about how bad Marquette was defensively, and that held up. I mean, they shot St. John's was right around 50% the entire game. So
yeah,
it was nice to see them kind of lead wire to wire.
Great job, Ryan. And that brings your record to 17 and 13. Very good. So you're doing a great job as well. So good job. Shout everyone out, Nikki T, Trey. What's up? Trey, by the way, I haven't talked to you. Get at me after the show. I want to chat with you about some things. Brad King, what's up? Jim Del Fiore, welcome. Jovan, Chris, Ashimusu, Brian George. There's your buddy, Ryan, Brian George. Brian, we need a photo circa at least 2010 there, pal. Let's get a new picture of your wife and you, if you're still together. I don't know if you are. Benny the Bull, I know the VIP Barbershop, they're out there listening.
Yep.
We got businesses listening to us now, Ryan. How about
that?
Yeah,
that's cool.
Shoddy K, Sergio Rodriguez, Best Gambler, everyone, welcome. So, Ryan, what we'll do, we'll kind of just go through the entire card. We might as well do this. This is something I'll just do for all the big cards. Won't really do it for, like, you know, the small ones, but, you know, I'll tack them. Because, I mean, I pretty much go over all the games anyway, so might as well. Okay, sounds good, Trey. Ryan, how you doing today?
I'm good.
I mean, you I'm all right. I haven't seen much of you, that's why.
No, yeah, I'm good. Doing fine, yeah. Tomorrow's Friday, so that's always a good thing for everyone. Work weeks are wrapping up here, so.
Every day's a Friday for me, Ryan.
Yeah, you're fortunate, yeah.
Let's jump in. First game on the card here. Northeastern visiting William & Mary. William & Mary -4, over under 151. You know, we talked about this one today on SBR. Peter Loschek mentioned he kind of like William & Mary. Yeah, I mean, I would probably lean that way as well. I mean, I'm not really interested in jumping in front of William & Mary at home. Northeastern has been a pesky team at times this year, but I've noticed with them lately, they've kind of tailed off. They had a bad showing at Delaware a couple weeks ago. I remember, I think you and I were both on that one. Again, I'm picking every game. I'll take William & Mary for the sake of the show. Not in love with it. Not going to be on my card or anything. I'll lay the 4 here.
Yeah, I mean, that's kind of a no-brainer for me. I would definitely go William & Mary. Had them the other night where they really took it to UNC Wilmington. And look, the way they're playing right now, haven't lost at home. Scoring, 94 points a game at home? That really kind of says something. And Northeastern, you're right, Jeff. They had a nice start to the season, knocked off some upper echelon teams. But lately, man, they're struggling. 1-4 in their last 5 straight up and to the number. So I don't like them, especially and on the road. So, William & Mary, I think, is a good play. I think William & Mary just in general is a good play tonight on the board. But
yeah, I mean, they definitely are. I mean, I think they'd be a really nice money line parlay play, throw them in with another team. Get it down to, you know, them just having a win. You know, those CAA games can get pretty interesting. Next one, Florida laying 20.5 at home against Missouri. Now, look, I know Missouri's bad. I'm aware of it. You know, I know that they're 5-15 and, you know, they're, you know, 1-7 on the road. But I don't need them to win. I just need them to hang within 20. Ryan, we've seen Florida play, okay? Are they a team that should be laying this kind of number in conference? Even at home, I mean, you look at an interesting stat here, but for me, it's important because I think, you know, this kind of defines teams as you go towards March and stuff. Florida is 4-12 over the last 3 years in February.
Yep.
So for whatever reason, they just kind of are dissolving when we turn over to Feb. So I'll lean with Missouri here. I'm gonna grab the points. Missouri's bad, but. You know, I like to lay big numbers with teams that, you know, really like, you know, can fill it up. And look, Florida can fill it up, but I think this one's like a 78-62 type of game. It'll be ugly. It'll be close, but I'm not laying 20 points in conference. I'm sorry.
Yeah, I really don't have too much on this game. I guess I'd slightly lean to the dog. Just, you know, Florida very up and down. So, I wouldn't want to lay, you know, 20 points with them.
Yeah, I mean, they're only... Your last 5 games, only shooting it at 44%. Yeah, Philly guy, you're back, but you know the rules here. Everyone knows the rules here. If you, and I'm gonna put this out to everyone right now, so we all just understand this. This show's been very fun lately, haven't it? Has
it, Ryan? Why?
Well, listen, I'm not gonna hold grudges against people. He has to come back and be on the show, and we're gonna do it. I get people don't like each other on here. I get there's certain people that have issues. I don't care who starts it. I don't care who finishes it. If you start stuff on the chat box, you will be blocked, and that will be for good. So everyone knows the rules. This is the last time I'm going to say it. I get certain people don't like each other, but I'm not going to put up with this back and forth stupid shit. So if it has nothing to do with the show, take it off the air. You know, I have no interest in caring. Burns, what's up, buddy? How you doing? Julian, everyone out there, welcome. So yeah, Ryan, I'll go with Missouri here. You know, not you're never going to make a lot of money betting on Missouri, but they're not that bad ATS. I mean, 6-9, it's not good.
Right.
It's not, you know, they're not 3-10 either though. So I'll play with fire here. We saw that.
I just worry about having a thing like LSU last night.
Oh yeah.
Where,
which by the way,
a
I
team
don't...
like you think, ah, man, they're not yeah. that bad, right?
Yeah.
You know, well, maybe they are. So
yeah, I'm not sure if you saw it either, but I saw at one point, did you see they had the lead down to 12? They got it down to 12.
Oh, yeah?
And I was like, oh, my God, LSU's going to come back. Huh. Then, like, 3 minutes later, I check it, they're down 25.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
And that's
how bad they
how
are.
It is,
but,
man.
Listen, all of it's set up. I'll take it. Listen, I'm not – it looked weird.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it is what it is. Florida Atlantic, Charlotte. You know, this would be a game I wouldn't be anywhere near if I didn't go over every game. I guess I'll lean Charlotte. I don't have much opinion. Charlotte can definitely score the basketball for sure. They're at home. That's kind of all I have to say about it. Is Florida Atlantic good at anything?
No, they're not.
You know, and I can't literally know a thing about every single team. These are two teams I haven't done too much with. Just because
right.
I'm not a big fan of Conference USA either. College of Charleston, UNC Wilmington, great game here in the CAA.
It is.
Wilmington had been on fire until last Saturday. Ryan, you mentioned you had William and Mary in that game. But Wilmington back at home here, kind of a clash of styles. We know Wilmington likes to go up tempo, press, all that kind of thing. Thing about Charleston you got to like, though, is good old team, play defense, can definitely handle the pressure. I just think Charleston's a better team, honestly. Wilmington's a better team. I just think they're a little bit more talented. I'll tell you what, though. Charleston seems to always play close games. I'll grab the points here.
One thing I like about Charleston, too, is they're scoring lately. I mean, they're scoring 75 points a game over the last five. So, you know,
yeah,
and offensively, it's kind of been their struggle on the season. I mean, they're only averaging 66 points a game. So, but as of lately, they're kind of found their stroke and kind of getting things straightened out, perhaps. So, it's definitely a tough one, just because just all the variables that go into it. I do have a slight lean to Charleston, though.
Yeah,
I would expect a close game.
I mean, they played a couple weeks ago, I believe, and it was Wilmington got the job done. Like you said, Charleston playing a little bit better, starting to get some balanced scoring.
They won by six.
Yeah. I'll think they can hang here. Looks like a close game. Probably comes down to the wire. Should be a great game. Oakland at Youngstown. Oakland's really falling off, Ryan, as
big
a team.
Time.
I think a lot of people thought they were a team that could challenge Valpo and the Horizon. Really tailed off. Youngstown State, though, I mean,
they're bad.
Are they ever good?
At anything?
No. I get, their football team's not bad in Division II.
Now. They're getting there, yeah.
But as far as basketball, they haven't been good for a while. But do you trust Oakland laying this kind of number? I'm going to tell you what. I'll trust them tonight. Not going to be anywhere near a card, but
they should definitely be able to score into the 80s against this team. I mean, Youngstown doesn't play a lick of defense. So
the problem I've seen with Oakland is, remember how we talked about how good they improved defensively? They're almost getting back to their old ways. So
maybe now that people are off of them now, everyone kind of bought into them. And, you know, obviously that's, you see what happens. You buy into a team like Oakland and they kind of falter. Now the kind of people are like, well, screw Oakland. Maybe they kind of get things straightened out.
Another one in the horizon, Cleveland State -6.5 in Detroit. This line's kind of weird, isn't it? I mean, why is Cleveland State laying 6.5 to anyone? Detroit's been better. Problem is, I like Detroit at home. That's kind of been my dealings with them. But listen, I don't think Cleveland State should be laying 6.5 to anyone. I'll grab Detroit. I can see Detroit winning.
I have no opinion on that one.
Okay. Drexel, Towson. No real opinion. I guess I wanted to do this, so I'll do it. I'll go Towson. I'll lay the number at home. Obviously, the clear talent advantage here for Towson. Drexel getting better, but we have to remember how low they are. So it's like a little bit better is not.
Yeah, look, really... Towson the better team. Towson the better team at home. The better defensive team, and Drexel. I tell you, they don't play defense at all, especially on the road. They're giving up 83 points a game. So that's the direction I would lean is Towson.
Yeah, I guess I'll buy into it. But as far as any game we've talked about so far, I won't be personally betting on. Next one, Michigan State at Nebraska. Talk about an interesting line here, Ryan. Nebraska, though, I've kind of seen the same song and dance to them. They get a win, one big win or two a game a year, and they kind of go away. Yeah. And there'll be thorns and sides at times, but then they just look lost at times. I get the feeling Michigan State, there's not a lot to look forward to with them, really. They kind of just have to win the Big Ten tournament to get into the tournament. Off a big win, I think Michigan State gets the job done tonight. I'll take the 1 point here. I'll go Michigan State money line here, -120. Off the big win, I'll take a shot with them here.
Yeah, that's kind of the way I'd go, Michigan State. I mean, now that they got Bridges back, look, when Bridges was out of the lineup, this is just a team that kind of want to stay away from. With him back, I would lean that way.
Delaware and Hofstra. Delaware on the road to Hofstra. Hofstra's really struggling this year, and it gets worse. Rocco's Gustis and Eli Pemberton may not play tonight, two of their better players. For me, look, Delaware's not good. They're not good on the road, but ever since that kid Daly, Ryan Daly, I believe his name is, ever since he's been inserted, they've had a little bit of a shot in the arm, playing a little bit better. We backed them last week. You backed them, actually, your play of the day. So for me, I'll go with Delaware plus 10.5.
And Hofstra is not good ATS at home. Now you're asking them to lay double digits, 10.5. Yeah, I think I'd go Delaware as well. They've, like you said, they've kind of come back to life a little bit here and been kind of pesky for teams. So
yeah, I think double digits a little too money. I think here. Another house cleaning issue, Ryan. We mentioned the quarrels with certain people. This is another pet peeve of mine on this show. If you come in 20 minutes late, 30 minutes late, you've clearly missed a lot. I'm not repeating what we already talked about. You can clearly listen back. This show is always there. I get we get new listeners every day, so I'm going to always have to reinforce this. But listen, we've discussed about 10 games so far. Unfortunately, we can't go back and through everything.
No.
So if you come on... it's like the people at church that come in 20 minutes late,
and they're
in the middle of a homily, and they say, "Well, what did I miss? I don't know where were we?"
Here's the thing. I mean, you can say that. Just maybe, someone on the chat box can address it. We're not going to address it. So, I mean, if someone on the chat box wants to say, "Oh, they really like this one," or they like that, you know what I mean?
So. And look, again, none of these games so far do I really have a huge opinion on. Detroit, that'd be about the only one that I'd consider looking at. But other than that, I don't have much. Elon James Madison. I would lean with Elon here. I think James Madison. They had their moment in the sun for about 3 or 4 games where they, started to cover and play decent. But Yohani Dalenberg gone, that hurts. Elon's been a great moneymaker this year for bettors. And Ryan, from what I understand, this is your play of the day. What do you like here?
Yeah, I do. I like Elon. I like the way they're playing lately. I mean, they've kind of caught my eye over the last week and a half, 2 weeks. And look, they've covered the last 5. They've covered 8 of 10 in this conference so far. I know we were kind of talking about this game earlier. I mentioned to you that I was going to use this as my play of the day. And, you did mention how they've kind of struggled ATS at home, kind of over the last 3 years, 11 and 18 to the number. But, against a James Madison, against a team that's 2-10 on the road, against a team that's 3-8 ATS, and they're not playing well lately, not playing particularly well in conference, and you mentioned Dalibert out of the lineup, that's just kind of another notch on the belt there for Elon. Yeah, I'm gonna go with Elon here. I think they're gonna definitely kind of be able to. This just looks to me like a double digit win. I'm sorry, it just kind of does to me. I like the way they're playing, and defensively, Elon really kind of, you know, hunkering down lately. 63 points a game over the last five. Think James Madison's gonna struggle to score in this one. So yeah, that's the direction I'm going, Jeff. Elon as my play of the day.
Yeah, I think it's a good play, Ryan. I actually brought them up on our roundtable we did the other day about a team to watch for bettors, and
yeah,
they've been great all year.
Yeah.
And they're a good road team, too. So, I hate to keep piling it on James Madison, but you know, when you suck, you suck. And Elon is, right. Elon's really been a tough
out. I mean, going on the road to a team that's playing really well right now. I don't want to go with James Madison.
And what I like about this line also is it doesn't look too good to be true.
No,
really.
Not fishy,
I mean, it's
at all.
At seven. You know, you're still laying a good amount.
It is.
You know, this
it's
one
not
of those,
like it's three or four.
Yeah, this is one of those work hard type of wins here. I like it. Memphis at South Florida. I gave this one out earlier. If you listened, you listened. If you didn't, you didn't. This is one of the free plays that I really liked. At 13, I really like it.
Yeah.
At 15, it's getting up there a little bit. It should still hit, and I'll still give it out at 15. Listen, Memphis should crush South Florida.
Yeah.
South Florida has just been a total mess all year. Ryan, it's pretty crazy because not only is South Florida, they fired their coach. Jamal McMurray left the program, who was their best player by a lot. Now Geno Thorpe, their Penn State transfer, who's their best scorer, he's probably not going to play tonight.
Yep.
It's been tough for South Florida this year. By the way, Mike Bibby Jr. is on South Florida. Did you know that?
I did not.
Yeah, and he's actually not bad.
Okay.
Yeah, Memphis, a lot of points laid on the road here, but, you know, this should be a blowout.
South Florida's bad.
Yeah.
I don't know what else you want to say. I mean, I just would not feel comfortable backing them in any situation, really. I know 15 points is a lot, but I mean, they're a bad team. I mean, is this not the team that just got what they
rolled
40?
Yeah,
against
Cincinnati.
So.
Yeah. And look, Memphis is quietly been what I kind of liked about them lately is they've really ramped up their defensive production. They played very well on the defensive end. Tubby Smith getting after it. And like Donnie said, if Geno Thorpe doesn't play, I don't know how they score.
Yeah.
I really don't. So I'll go with Memphis here in this one. Just kind of think it's a pretty easy one here.
Agreed.
Florida International, Old Dominion, no real opinion. Unders at 120.5. How about that?
Super low.
Yeah. I don't know much about Florida International. All those Florida schools I don't know much about, like Florida International, Florida Atlantic.
Yeah, because they're all dog shit.
Yeah, a couple of those shitty schools down there. I don't ever get involved with them in football or in basketball. That's a little spit there, Ryan. You see that?
No, I didn't. You do that sometimes. But
well,
right.
I mean, I talk a lot here. I wish I didn't have to pick this game. Fuck. I'll go under 120.5.
Yeah.
I guess I'll hope that Old Dominion just really locks down defensively.
All right.
Which they could definitely do.
Mm-hmm.
There's
very
a reason this total is this low. So hopefully it's like 60-49 or something. Western Kentucky, Louisiana Tech. Jacoby Boykins back for La Tech. That's big. Their point guard. Did you see that the other week, Ryan? West Kentucky, UAB, I believe it was. They got into a brawl. La Tech had to play the game with four players for like 3 minutes at the end.
No kidding.
And outscored UAB.
Wow.
How's that possible?
Wow.
20-16, they outscored them.
No kidding. No,
crazy,
I didn't see that. Wow, that's pretty cool. I'm surprised I didn't see that anywhere.
Yeah. West Kentucky, long term, maybe it'll get better under Rick Stansbury. But in this one, I would probably lay the points at home with La Tech. Any opinion here on this one?
With La Tech, West Kentucky, no, I do not have an opinion on this one.
Middle Tennessee, Texas, San Antonio. I'm going to lay the rare 13.5 with MTSU. I don't like to ever lay this kind of number with them, but UTSA is pretty poor.
Middle Tennessee is good, too, and they're a good ATS. I mean, if this isn't a team people have looked at,
Well, they're good as a like 10-point or lower favorite.
Sure, yeah.
At 13.5, I'm a little more skeptical. Your boys, Ryan, Illinois, Chicago, at Green Bay.
They are.
Yeah. Green Bay, decent team this year. I'll back Illinois, Chicago solely off the against the spread success this year. I mean, I'm getting 7 here. I hope that they can keep it close here. What do you think?
I worry about them a little defensively, Illinois-Chicago. Look, this is a team that we've kind of come to know. We've talked about them a lot, you know, on the show, my Play of the Day segment. So, on the road, I'm a little concerned. But, you know, Wisconsin-Green Bay, it's not like they're anything special either. I guess I'll have a slightly lead with Chicago for the ATS numbers, but I do worry defensively that they'll be able to get enough stops.
Yeah, I mean, I hear you on that. It's maybe the over. Green Bay loves to run up tempo, very high tempo, high possession team. But Illinois-Chicago, they've been good to me. I'll take a shot with them. Valpo-Milwaukee, I go Valpo here. Milwaukee is trash to the highest degree.
I was actually looking at Valpo earlier today. Yeah, I like Valparaiso in the spot.
Yeah. Please stop asking us certain games. We're discussing every game. We've made it clear 8,000 times. So you don't need to ask if we're going to cover a certain game. We'll go over everyone. Yeah, I'll go Valpo. They have really turned it up lately. Been playing better. Alec Peters, always the best player on the court.
It'll be interesting to see what they look like once he's gone. That's for sure.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, we always make the joke, and I know a lot of people make the joke of, this so-and-so player's been there for 10 years. He's one of them that seems like he's been there a long time.
Plus, like, it's not like they're a team that gets five-star recruits all the time.
Not at all.
Yeah, they got something waiting in the wings. Plus, Bryce Drew's gone. I mean, it's long-term, how good will they be here going forward? Marshall, Southern Miss. I'll go with Marshall here. Southern Miss is pretty bad.
Yeah.
One of the worst teams. In this conference, you know, you maybe think over, but then Southern Miss doesn't really score too much. I'll lay the 9. Arizona, Oregon State. Interesting game here, Ryan. Arizona going on the road, kind of a dead spot in their schedule, if you could say so. And I've noticed, and I've even pointed it out, I don't know if it was to you, but I pointed out that they always end up winning by like 14 or like 15. Arizona never seems to blow anyone out. It's kind of weird.
Well, ever since that UCLA game, I mean, like you said, they've kind of hit a lull point in their schedule where, I mean, the teams they're playing are pretty lackluster. And, I mean, they haven't really, I don't think, really disposed of anyone. I mean, Washington State hung around for a while. I forget who else they played.
Arizona State covered them.
They covered. I mean, so teams are kind of hanging around and, like you said, winning in that kind of low teen area. So
here's the problem, though. Oregon State is fucking trash.
They're bad.
They're awful. Yeah. At least with Arizona State, they could score, and you know, Washington State's going to give, you know, people some trouble.
Yep.
There we go again with this.
Just relax, dude. It's all right.
It pisses me off.
Why?
Because I'm sick of people asking if we're going to go over certain games. That's why. I'll lay it, Ryan. I think they covered it.
All right.
I think they win 79-59. Oregon State.
I mean, they're bad. Yeah, it just depends on how motivated are they. I mean,
yeah.
This is a game that I like. So
I don't think that can Arizona ever not be motivated. No, they've never made a. They've never won a Final Four.
They're 20-2.
Right.
So,
I think you want to continue to see cohesiveness.
I mean, when you're 19, 20 years old, you're 20-2, and you're playing a team in Oregon State. I mean, that's just the way they think. We're gonna win. So we're not gonna lose. Mm-hmm. They're not looking at lines. So
yeah, I know.
But yeah.
But I just think Oregon State's that bad. Probably.
Mm-hmm.
Do I have an opinion on the total? Well, I think it's gonna be 79-59. So that would be 138. So I would probably say
that's
over. If you like the over, I mean, you kind of missed out. I mean, it's up to 132.
131.5.
Yeah, it was at 128 earlier today. So you and everyone else likes the over. So I don't know. Maybe you missed out there. I'll go Arizona -16. Utah-Cal. Utah seems like a real trendy pick tonight.
Yeah.
At the end of the day, Cal's a fantastic defensive team. I like Utah. The problem for me in this one and why I will be nowhere near this game. I'll give a prediction, but I don't really want to. Utah is a fantastic offensive team. They're really efficient. Ever since they got Collette and Barefield and Kuzma, all them playing really cohesive. I feel at some points Cal struggles to score. I'll tell you what I'm going to do, Ryan. I'm going to go over 135 here.
Okay.
I think this one gets over. I think we could see like a... I don't know, 71-68 type of game here. It's going to be tough, but I think it gets over 135 somehow. Cal has everyone healthy. That's going to improve.
Yeah, I don't have too much on this game, but you know the way that they kind of get after it defensively, especially at home, Cal does. You know, I like Utah. I do. I like Utah this year. Like you said, the way they've kind of stepped it up offensively. But I like Cal at home, or I like Utah at home more than anything. Obviously, I kind of lean Cal here. I see where you're coming from with a total, but I kind of like Cal. I know a lot of people might see Utah and say, "Ah, 4.5." I'll gladly grab that, but I don't know why. I got a feeling Cal gets the job done tonight.
Yeah, Cal is definitely, like I said, if I had a lean, I would probably go with Cal. I think defensively they're pretty strong. I think with everyone healthy, they're.
I mean, you have to ask yourself, what do you put more value in? Do you put more value in offense or do you put more value on defense? And I'm more inclined to say I put more value on defense, especially when a team's at home. I mean.
I don't know what it is, but I like this conference. I always like watching their games.
Pac-12
like,
basketball?
Yeah, I really enjoy. There's something about West Coast basketball that I thoroughly enjoy. Like, even if it's like, I hate SEC basketball.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
But, like, I could sit and watch Pac-12 basketball. Like, I watched that USC-Washington game last night.
Mm-hmm.
It was just, it's just crisp. Yeah. I like it, you know? I'll lean Cal, but my play in this one will be over 135. UTEP, UAB. Call me crazy, Ryan. I'm going to go with the home team here. I'm going to take the 6 points. This one looks like a trap, I think. UTEP is, bad. But Tim Floyd, for what it's worth, they always play hard. They're a pretty good defensive team. Offensively, they've been pretty good lately. Been able to hit some shots. UAB's been a bad team on the road. 1-6 ATS this year. I'll take a shot with UTEP at home plus 6. I think they're going to play hard tonight. Yes, we will. That will be the last.
How about this? You ask for a game, we won't go over. How about that? Make Jeff happy. When you ask for a game, that means we're not going to go over.
I get the feeling Dick Thurber is
trouble. Is a porn star?
Dick Thurber.
Dick Thurber.
Is that really his name? It could be his name. I don't want to do that. Sorry. But I'll go with UTEP here, Ryan.
Yeah, I know.
You see where I'm coming
from. No opinion, though.
Right?
Yeah.
I think some things check out here. The one issue with UTEP is a free throw percentage is a problem. So we'll see. I'll take a shot with plus 6, and I just dropped my pen. Great.
Pick it up.
Let me grab that.
It's all right.
Oh, man. Let me write that down here. You should be doing this.
You're the one making a pick for every game.
No offense, Dick, but what's there to go over in that game? I'll go over in it. I actually think it's not a horrible game.
Is it like the last play on the card?
Or? Last game on the card, Fullerton, Santa Barbara. Not much of an opinion here on this one. Santa Barbara is really bad. I'll lay the points with Fullerton. I don't want to do it. Two of the worst teams in the country. By the way, Santa Barbara, Mitchell Kupchak. Do you know who he's related
to? I've heard of him, yeah.
Yeah, he's related to Mitch Kupchak. How about that? But other than that, they don't have much to look forward to out in Gaucho land. They've been really jumped on with injuries this year. I'll take a shot with Fullerton here. Pepperdine, San Francisco. We've learned this Waves team's pretty bad.
Mm-hmm.
San Francisco, locked down defensively lately. I'll take a shot with the what's their mascot here?
Who?
San Francisco. I forget. I think they're the Gauchos also. I'll take a shot. I'll take a shot with San Francisco here.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't have anything. I hate, dude. I mean, I know you like West Coast basketball.
Yeah.
I really, besides St. Mary's and Gonzaga, I hate the West Coast Conference. All these teams are fucking terrible.
Santa Clara, Portland. Santa Clara's played better lately, but I'm not sure they're worthy of laying 5. Problem is, I think Portland without wintering is really bad. This one looks kind of like a trap. I'll tell you what. I'll take a shot with Portland plus 5.
All right. Home dog, yeah.
Are they this bad? I guess I'll take
the
a shot.
The Dons.
Okay, the Dons.
That's
right. Thank you.
Forgot.
I didn't actually forgot about that.
I did forgot.
Yeah. I don't believe in Santa Clara.
Me either.
Loyola Marymount, San Diego. This one looks like a trap. I'll go San Diego plus 1.5. Play hard. Loyola Marymount. obviously a much better team than San Diego. Why are they only laying 1.5 here?
Yep.
Kind of doesn't make any sense. St. Mary's Pacific. I'm going to go under 123. Pacific, very slow-paced. You also look at St. Mary's, second slowest pace in the country. I think this one truly is like a 64-48 type of game. I'm going to go under 123 here. I think this is very low scoring.
Yeah, I like the direction. And obviously, like we've said before on the show, is when you get up to these higher numbers involving St. Mary's, it's hard for them to kind of get that separation because of the limited possession. So, yeah, I think under is the right side.
Yeah, let's move on. Gonzaga, Brigham Young. A lot of people want to talk about this one.
Yep.
Lines moved. It was at 10. This morning it's down to 8.5. Now it's back up to 10. Public clearly likes Gonzaga in this spot. Do you see any reason to back Brigham Young here, Ryan? Obviously, there's a reason that they're at home. They are probably one of the better teams Gonzaga's going to play the rest of the year.
Well, I think the biggest question you have to ask is, what's the deal with Nick Emery?
Right. That's a big question.
I mean, really.
And it's not a it's a sickness. It's not an actual injury.
Yes.
That would be my thing. If Emery doesn't play, which, looking at the line, I don't think he's going to play. The question I have also is, Gonzaga's been laying big numbers and been covering them. Is BYU that good, really? Mm-hmm. I mean, I've watched them play. I mean,
yep.
Mika's a good player, the big. But it's easy to play against Portland. But now you got to play against Karnowski, who's an absolute tank. You know, I like, you know, Halls and Emery. But even if Emery plays, I mean, I just think Gonzaga's just a step above everyone else. You know, I get the feeling, you know, a lot of people thought that, you know, St. Mary's was a team, they were going to give Gonzaga some trouble. And, you know, from the kennel, if this was in the kennel, clearly it'd be a different outcome. But even in Marriott Center, like I said, Jimmy Fredette ain't walking through the door, Ryan.
Yeah.
He's not suiting up tonight. So they probably would need him tonight, though. If Jimmy Fredette plays, who would win this game? Hypothetically. Let's say you take Jimmy Fredette right now and put him on St. Mary's. Or
I think it'd be a situation where BYU could potentially win the game, to be honest with you.
Okay, well, that's what I'm asking.
So,
because I think if Fredette played,
I think there'd definitely be a chance.
Yeah, it would probably be a lot better outcome.
And closer. If the line was, the line would obviously wouldn't be 10 points. Because
the great thing about Fredette was he literally took games over.
Well, sure.
Like, he would beat a team on his own.
Yes.
So I feel like this line would be totally different, obviously,
well,
if he's
obviously,
in there.
Yeah.
So what would be the line that you would, what do you think the line would be?
The line would be if Jimmer, like if four? You put him in this, yeah, probably 3.5 or 4, I'd say.
What would you take?
I think he was
a transcendent.
I think I'd
play.
Still take Gonzaga personally.
Would you really? Wow.
Just as an overall team.
Do you think this is the best Gonzaga team we've seen? Because you've seen a lot of
them.
Yeah,
obviously, I think.
Okay.
I think so. And that's the thing about Gonzaga, and that's kind of
the that one, damn Dick Adam.
Here's the thing, though. Here's the thing I like about Gonzaga, but here's the thing, and this is what I think differentiates this Gonzaga team compared to other Gonzaga teams. Is and I'm big on this. I am. And if you look, I mean, you can, with the exception of a couple teams that get hot in the tournament and just go on nutty runs, like UConn a couple years ago with Kemba, and I mean, it happens. But you look at these teams. I mean, Gonzaga had. What, Adam Morrison? What was the long hair kid's name? The big, when they were a one seed,
Kelly Olynyk.
They had him. He was
we
their star.
The team like
he was their star guy. This team though is like a team.
Yeah.
Like the, I mean, let's be honest. There's no superstar on Gonzaga this year. There's not.
There's like a lot of graduate
so
transfers,
a lot of
and
good
like yeah.
all around basketball players, and I think that more than anything helps teams as they get into March. So I would say yes.
I thought the Pangos team with like Sabonis. Karnowski, Gary Bell, that was a pretty good team.
It was.
But I think the best teams, like, and I'm just kind of putting this out there and we'll move on, but I think the best team that I've seen on the West Coast, like in this conference, you remember that St. Mary's team with Samhan?
Omar Samhan.
Yeah. Mickey McConnell, Dellavedova. That team was good.
It was good.
That was
they
beat Villanova.
Villanova.
Yeah. That was a great,
great
team.
Yeah.
That was probably one of my favorite teams out in the West Coast in a while. That was back in like 2010, 2011.
It's a long time ago.
Have you seen Samhan lately?
No.
You wouldn't recognize him. He's like skinny.
Oh, he's skinny.
He plays over in like somewhere
overseas.
He's really good though. He plays over in like Japan or something.
Right.
But yeah, that was Trey, how old are you when Sam Hen was relevant? You'd have been like 15. You're pretty young, that's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
That was a good number of years ago. That was probably 5-6 years ago.
It's probably like 6 or 7.
Because I remember I lived in Philly at the time, I think. And that was
like 6 or 7 years ago.
Yeah, that was a good 5-6 years ago. Yeah, I'll go with Gonzaga minus the 10. I think they're just a step better than BYU. I'm not really impressed with this BYU team this year.
No.
Arizona State, Oregon. You know, this is an interesting one because, you know, Arizona State is bad either way. But can they score in Oregon? Oregon's pretty good defensively.
They are. And yeah, Oregon, too.
Arizona State was able to do it against Arizona, who I think is better than Oregon defensively. This is a tough one. I'll lay the number. I think Oregon pounds them tonight.
Kind of the way I lean too. Oregon State not really interested in trying to, you know. And that's the thing with these games. It's like I don't want to hold my breath. I don't want to hold my breath with a team in Arizona State that's just that bad defensively on the road here. I'll go Oregon.
Was the Sandman that long ago? 2008?
I think it was early in that. I think it was like 2008, 2009. We weren't in high school. We weren't. We had graduated.
Yeah, we were like just out. But I'm trying to remember the Villanova team. It was like, I think Ochefu was literally like, I don't think he was even
there. I don't think he was there.
Find that out for me, will you? I'd like to know that. Yeah, Salmon was just huge. And their guards were like all Australian.
Yep.
And they would, I remember McConnell had that. Remember he would shoot the ball really high? Do you remember that kid?
Yep.
They had a really good team. That was a great, great squad. Hawaii, UC Riverside. Fuck if I know. I don't like backing Hawaii on the road in the mainland. I'll take Riverside minus, what do we got, 3. Colorado-Stanford. This is a good one, Colorado-Stanford. Definitely a tough one. A couple people asked me about it. With Reed Travis back, I think Stanford is better. I'm just not sure how good they are. Colorado played a little bit better lately.
2010.
Yeah, I thought it was around that time. Okay, so it was about 6 years ago, seven years ago.
Yep.
Coming up on 7 years.
Yep.
What do you think about Colorado-Stanford? Colorado's played better. Stanford, decent, but, you know, definitely going through their lumps.
You know, yeah, and at home, they battled there for a while with Cal on the road. I would lean Colorado.
Lean Colorado. Getting points, I think that's worth a look. Wofford Citadel, I mentioned earlier, I'm on the over, 182.5. I don't really know how to, like, say it, but, like, I mean, Wofford, 78 points a game. They're giving up 47% shooting. Citadel at home, Ryan, 102 points a game, giving up 97. Both these teams shoot free throws at a really high level, both over 75%. Both teams foul a lot, should see a lot of baskets, quick baskets, foul shots. Opponents are shooting 53% against the Citadel.
Still, yeah.
I mean, it's just astounding. Last four games went over. 16 of 23 in this series have gone over. This one earlier this year, I think it was 104-103. I think this one's like 98-92.
I think it's good the fact that Wofford is a good over team, like you kind of mentioned. Yeah. Is, you know, obviously you get in those situations with the Citadel when they kind of face those good defensive teams, and that kind of slows things down. But Wofford, very similar to Citadel, and I think that plays kind of right into the overhand. Because if you look, the over in Citadel games has really slowed down. I think in conference are like 3-6 to the under.
Well, that's because they've played the last two games, their scoring's been down, but they played Mercer, who is really good defensively.
Oh, that's what
and
I'm saying.
Tempo-wise, they're very slow.
That's what I'm saying, exactly.
Yeah. Now you're facing a team that's kind of similar to you.
Right.
And there's no... I mean, Citadel averages like 86 possessions a game. That's ridiculous.
What's their
odd.
Offense called?
The Loot and Shoot.
Loot and Shoot. That's right. That's classic.
And
Loot and Shoot.
That's their goal. So look for this one to get high.
Man.
We basically need 94-93.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we're going to get it over. So could see overtime. You're going to see a lot of foul shots in this game. Furman Mercer should be a good one. Mercer, I'm never interested in fading at home. Bob Hoffman always does a great job at home, and they're a good defensive team. Really work possessions out, good schematically. I'll go Mercer minus two.
Yeah, I go Mercer strictly from this is a game I actually looked at earlier today in depth a little bit, and I actually go Mercer strictly for the fact that they're at home. I would take the home team in this matchup. This matchup's pretty even. And I like Furman. Furman's actually a team I've actually had my eye on for the last couple weeks. This team's been playing some really good basketball, but Mercer being at home, I like.
Yeah. Ryan loved Baylor that year with Tweedy Carter. He loved Baylor. I remember they played San Diego State that year, Baylor. And you rode them for like a couple weeks straight.
Yeah.
Yeah, you liked Baylor back when we were younger.
Yep, I do remember that.
East Tennessee State and VMI. VMI is fucking trash. ETSU is
very much
best team in that conference. I'll lay the 12. Greensboro, Chattanooga. I'm going to grab the points with UNCG. Pretty good team. Chattanooga's kind of been a little bit, they've struggled a little bit lately. I'll take the points. We got Western Carolina, Samford. I mean, want to back WCU? Exactly. I'm good. I'll lay the 12. Eastern Illinois, Tennessee State. Tennessee State's not played well lately. I'll take Eastern Illinois plus 7. Eastern Illinois' record, it's not going to do much for you, but Tennessee State has really been down lately. Niagara-Fairfield. I have a feeling a lot of people bet Fairfield tonight. I'm going to take Niagara. I think Niagara will be able to score, hang with this one, maybe keep it close.
Yeah.
I think Fairfield's kind of a trap. Weber-Southern Utah. Weber is way better than everyone in this conference. Southern Utah is astoundingly bad defensively. do you see those
laying
numbers?
Laying 18, too. I mean, it's a big number, but yeah, I'm definitely on that side.
Really absolutely. Shouldn't matter. Eastern Washington, Sac State. I hate Eastern Washington normally, but I'll lay it with them here.
Not sure why. They've been pretty profitable this year. But
yeah, I just had some bad luck with them early this year, but they've improved.
That's a no-no, though. Don't you always say that? Don't hold grudges on teams.
Yeah, look, I know.
In conference, they're 7-1 ATS. I like Eastern Washington. This was actually another game that I was looking at earlier today. So
yeah.
I like Eastern Washington.
What I've learned about the Eagles is they've gotten a lot better on the defensive end, which I think a lot of people were surprised by. Northern Arizona, Idaho State, I mean – These might be the two worst teams in the country. Northern Arizona is really pitiful.
Remember a couple years ago, they weren't bad.
The Lumberjacks, yeah. I remember that, actually. They had a kid named Chris Yanku, I remember.
Mm-hmm.
they were not bad.
They weren't bad. They were pretty profitable, yeah.
And Idaho State's got Ethan Telfair. So, that's just not as bad as you might think. But, I mean, do you really want to back Northern Arizona? I'll tell you what, I'm gonna lay the points with the Bengals here. I think Ethan Telfair has a monster game tonight. Belmont Murray, I'm gonna avoid. I have a play on that game. Portland State, Idaho. Loshak mentioned he liked Idaho. I tend to like the dogs in this conference. I'll go Portland State plus 3.5. And then Mount St. Mary's. Mount St. Mary's is one of the better teams in the what is this conference? The Northeastern Conference. You got LAU Brooklyn and Wagner.
Interesting conference.
Brian is bad. Brian. I haven't seen much of these teams. And like Trey said, what is there really to talk about? Mount St. Mary's is a better team. But just because they're a better team doesn't mean shit. I backed Lehigh the other night and they got crushed. So
true.
Don't get too high on this one. I'm actually not going to even pick this one just because it's not even... That's not normally lined or anything, so I'm going to leave this one off. So there we go, Ryan, the whole card. How about that?
Yeah.
I skipped one or two games. How about that? So we'll see how we do. A lot of games.
It is. It's a good card tonight.
I could lose every one of them. We'll see. That would be pretty hard to do.
I doubt that, though.
But if I did, do you really say why you suck? I mean, I clearly know a lot about this.
I don't know. That'd be pretty bad, though.
But, it would just be bad luck.
Yeah.
It's not like I'm, like, I know about every team here.
Yeah.
I mean, but let's move on. Let's talk about the Super Bowl. We're just going to talk about the game itself. Not going to talk about any props right now. We're just going to talk about the game. And I don't like this format, Jeff. It's quality over quantity. Don't listen. I'm just doing it today. I mean, it's just for fun, really. You know, there's not a lot going on anywhere else, so I'm just going with it. It's just for fun. We'll go back to the regular format on Monday. Just kind of something we tried. You're the only one that doesn't like this format, actually. I've had a lot of people say, like, can you do this game? Can you do this game? Can you do this game? I just say, well, I'll just do all of them. We still have -3 on the Super Bowl. That hasn't moved. I don't think it's going to.
Probably not.
I think the books are just confident this number. I mean, it makes sense.
It's a standard number for a close game like this.
Makes sense on both sides. Total has moved a little bit. What do you have that at?
58.
Which, I will comment on the total. I think it's, again, it's high. I mean, we all know that. 58, really high. One of the highest ever. The problem is, and we've talked about Atlanta at length. Do you trust them on thinking that they're any good on defense? I don't. Tom Brady.
You're right. And in a neutral site, look, they were fortunate enough to have home field advantage in the playoffs. Yeah, and defensively, look, they kind of are what they are. I mean, what do they give up on the year? Something like 20-some points. Yeah, they've given up 20. They give up, on average, 25 points a game. So, do I feel comfortable with them? No. I mean, I wouldn't. A team that kind of relies on turnovers, too, got some kind of uncharacteristic turnovers from Aaron Rodgers and kind of ran with it, and things got out of hand early. You can't expect that with a guy like Tom Brady. So, it's obviously just going to come down to the offenses, really. I mean, really. And it's going to come down to the offenses. Because I don't think that while the Patriots' defense is good, I don't think they're as good as kind of their numbers have talked about. I talked about it last week facing Pittsburgh, and they were very fortunate Le'Veon Bell goes out of that game early. Very fortunate. Not saying the game's going to change the outcome, but make things more difficult. But they haven't faced anyone. The Patriots haven't faced anyone to be respectable since that Seattle game. Since the Seattle loss, they haven't faced anyone. This will be the best offense and the most weapons they've had to cover all year. Matt Patricia has been talked about as a head coach candidate. We're really going to learn something about him. If he can come out here, limit this team to 21, 24 points, in my opinion, that's a win.
Yeah, I think you're
playing. I don't think it's realistic to say that they're going to hold them to 17 points.
I think you're playing with fire if you bet the under in this game. I really do. There's a reason it's set that high. And look, a lot of people are going to bet the over, for sure. But a lot of bunnies bet in the Super Bowl regardless. I mean, it's not like, does it really matter? I mean, how many people bet this game?
I don't think so. I think this is one game you don't need to really look at that.
No. There's been no movement in the line. It's not going to be any movement. I think if you bet the over, I think that's the right side. I really do. I'm not sure how you can bet the under here. I don't know how that makes any sense.
Yep.
I don't think it makes any sense.
I don't like it.
Because I think both defenses are bend but don't break. And like you said, New England, look, they've been good. But you have to remember, I mean, they've been a very bend but don't break defense. I mean, they're just not allowing teams to score touchdowns.
Both teams will score. I mean, yeah. I would be extremely surprised if this is a 21-20 game. 24-20 game. Same. I would be surprised. Like if it's halfway through the second quarter and it's 10-7,
yeah.
I'm gonna be like, what the hell?
Yeah.
You know, that would surprise me. It really would.
Yeah. For a total play, I would go over personally.
Yeah.
And Ryan, again, I want to say we've had a great year with the NFL. We've done well with this. We gave all our stuff out for free, and we had the NFL show, which was a fun show.
Yes.
We always came on and had fun with that about an hour before game time. But by the way, what is the over-under that Nicky T says that he went 7-0 this week?
I think he's doing that jokingly.
No, he
this one jokingly.
Right, but he literally said it 4 or 5 times in the last in the show, a time limit. What's the over-under ride on that?
Any more, probably. 2? Probably none.
Okay, yeah. But like, if we didn't say anything, how many times would you have said it? It was funny because Chris goes, Nicky, my God, we get it. You went 7-0 yesterday.
Yeah, he called him out, yeah.
It's like, how many times are you going to say the same thing? But yeah, as far as the over, that would be the total play for me. As far as the side, I like New England in this game. I'm going to lay the number with New England. Listen, Atlanta's a good team. They've done great this year. But as far as for me, I'm just not going to bet against Tom Brady. I don't know how else you want me to say it. Bill Belichick, I think with this amount of time to prepare for Julio Jones and for this offense, I think what you said makes a lot of sense, Ryan. I think Patricia's going to have a pretty good game. I don't think he's going to shut them down. I think they'll score 24 points probably or 27 points. I think this one's like a 34-27 type of game honestly. I think Tom Brady is someone I don't want to bet against. And I truly believe the Atlanta Falcons are a hideous defensive team. And I think we're going to see that in retrospect on Sunday. I think we see a wild game. I think this is a fun game. It might be a 3 or 4 point game late. But I think the New England Patriots will do enough to win this one by 7 to 10 points. I like New England here.
Yeah,
I'm really high on that one.
Yeah, this is tough. This is a tough one for me because I'm with Jeff in the fact that you don't want to go against New England. It's just not something we like to do over here. And then the other side is just, you know, Atlanta just seems to be one of those teams that just has really kind of caught fire. I mean, and it's not like they haven't beaten anyone. I mean, they beat Denver. They should have went to Seattle and beat Seattle if not for that horrendous no pass interference call. I forget the other game. I forget the other wins that they have on their schedule. But they have some pretty respectable wins. And Atlanta, look, I think Atlanta. I don't think this is a fluke either for Atlanta. I think Atlanta is a legit good. I mean, the way their offense is clicking, the amount of weapons they have. It's like, okay, you want to take Julio away from us? All right, we got Sanu. We got the two guys out of the backfield. I mean, really. I mean, Taylor Gabriel, where that guy's come from. You think the Cleveland Browns are kicking themselves for letting him walk out the door? I mean, they just kind of have a lot of places they can go, and that's why I kind of think I think the over is probably the strongest play. But because I think both teams will definitely kind of be able to score. I'm going to go with Atlanta. Screw it. I'm going to go with Atlanta and take the three. I am. I'm going to go with Atlanta.
I don't know how.
I'm going to go with Atlanta and take the three. Because
they're a kind of
I'm not.
They're terrible defensively.
I hear you. But I really like Atlanta's offense, and I think they're going to be able to score on New England. I really think they're going to be able to score on the Patriots this year or on Sunday. And look, defensively, yes, they're nothing special. But I don't know. It's just kind of a hunch.
But even you said it, and I think you said something kind of unknowingly, but you mentioned it. Other than Aaron Rodgers, I mean, the Packers played horrible. I mean, defensively, they were terrible. Yep. They turned the ball over way too much. Was that more that they kind of just played terrible, or was it that Atlanta was that good? They just cashed in. I mean,
yeah.
It sucks that, you know, Ripkowski fumbles at the 1 yard line.
Yep.
I mean, it sucks that, you know, Aaron Rodgers, you know, is really the only one playing tough. Green Bay's defense is awful.
Yeah.
Seattle. I mean, let's remember that when Earl Thomas went out, after that they were like one of the worst pass defenses in the league.
Yeah.
No. And Seattle was battling. I mean, they were hot and cold all year.
Yep.
Green Bay beat, or New England beat Pittsburgh. In all due respect, it was in New England. That's fine. You know, and they beat Houston. I don't think either team's really faced much of a hurdle to get here.
Not really. Not really at all.
And let's not kid ourselves here, Ryan. This might be, as far as talent's concerned and teams are concerned, one of the worst years in the NFL in a while. I mean, there weren't very many good teams this year. A couple. Yeah. And luckily, the Cowboys were beaten.
Yeah.
Who knows what would happen with them.
Sure.
So, yeah, I just don't think that, for me, I think that the thing on the side that you can always lean on to is you have Tom Brady at the end of the day.
Mm-hmm.
So, and I trust New England's defense a little bit more than I trust Atlanta's.
Yeah.
Plus, Bill Belichick against
Dan Quinn.
Here's the thing. What do you like there?
Dan Quinn's been in, two of the last three Super Bowls? Or three of the last four, something like that, with Seattle. And Seattle probably should have, he was a defensive coordinator for Seattle. He should have beat New England. I mean, if his head coach, Pete Carroll, runs the ball down at the 1 yard line, we obviously all remember that. They win that game. And defensively, look, and obviously their defense was a lot better, but scheme wise, maybe Dan Quinn kind of has something on his sleeve for Tom Brady, who struggled in that Super Bowl up until kind of halfway through the fourth quarter against Seattle. So it'll be interesting. I think it's going to be a good game. I really don't think it's going to be a 7 to 10 point kind of outcome either way, kind of like you think. I really think it's going to be a good game where it's going to come down to, and if New England covers, I think they cover anywhere from like 4 to 7, somewhere in that range. That's kind of, that's my feel on it.
Yeah, Nathan Jones, that might be a good point. I mean, you know, I think it maybe if you like New England, maybe just lay the 155, you know, and just, you don't got to worry about, you know, winning by one or two and you lose.
Yeah.
Because it could be a close game.
Yeah.
I just think New England will do enough to get the job done. I think, am I crazy to say that Atlanta's kind of gimmicky a little bit?
I don't think they're gimmicky at all.
Well, no, they're like really like, they're great offense and like, they're maybe a one-trick pony a little bit.
Well, they obviously win with their offense.
Right.
I mean, that's kind of the way, that's the truth, is they win with their offense. I mean, Christ.
So do you really want
to? They've scored at least 30 points in like 7 or 8 straight games.
Right.
That's fantastic. That's like Peyton Manning Denver numbers, Tom Brady in 08 numbers.
Bill Belichick.
Right.
Yeah, I think he's going to prepare. But I think it's going to be fun, right? We're going to be on the opposite sides here. Maybe, like, if you like Atlanta, I think if you like Atlanta.
If you like Atlanta, take the money.
That's what I would
absolutely
do.
Absolutely.
Yep. Yeah, so as far as, again, John, I don't do first half, so I don't really have any opinion on first halves. You know, once in a while I'll do them, you know, just because it might be the right side, but I don't really do first halves, man, sorry. So you're going to go with Atlanta, money line?
I would kind of lean Atlanta.
Okay. Yeah. You would kind of lean Atlanta.
Yeah, I told you, I don't like the side particularly as much as I like the total.
Okay.
I'm going to tell you right now, I'm still not 100% sure if I'm going to bet the side,
yeah.
But if I do, if I wake up Sunday morning and I decide I want to, it's going to be on Atlanta money line.
Okay.
I made it clear that I really like the over.
You know what I like to do with the Super Bowl, Ryan? I always like to do the correlated reverse where you go, you know, New England and the over,
mm-hmm.
you know?
Yeah, side
that's,
and...
That's
and
probably what I'll do.
Yeah.
I'll do 100 reverse, you know, New England, you know.
Right.
If I hit both, at 400.
Yeah.
All right, good. Well, that didn't take too long, you know?
So. No, it's pretty cut and dry. I mean, really.
Ryan, do you have anything else for us tonight?
Yeah, we can do some questions.
Let's do the questions.
Yep, we can do those.
Are there any non-sports?
Yeah, there's a couple.
Cool.
First one is, actually, three of them are non-sports related. First one, though. Baylor, Kansas last night.
Yeah.
Another big matchup, another top five matchup.
Yeah, great game.
It was a very good game. Did Baylor change your opinion of them with that performance last night, with really hanging tough and having a chance to win that game? Do you think this is a team going forward that can make a run?
No, I don't. I don't think they can. I think the issue I had with them is, like I say, Motley was disappeared. I
mean, that was the big thing. Yeah.
And, you know...
Is that his fault? Is that coaching?
Yeah, well, Scott Drew's a mental midget. We've talked about that before. I think they're just kind of they're too wonky for me. Like, you know, they're very like, you know, Lecomp just jacks threes, and you know they're just not. They should have won that game. I mean, they played good enough. They just, you know, you got to attack Landon Lucas. You get him out of the game. I mean, you don't have anything down low.
Yeah.
I didn't think Kansas played great. I mean, they couldn't really hold a lead. Was it good that they hung around? Yeah, but I'm not really about, you know, moral victories in this game. It was good, but are they as good as Kansas? No, I don't think they are. I don't think they're a team that can go too deep. Maybe Sweet 16 is their top, I think. But I thought them being in the top five most of the year was kind of ridiculous. They're good. I don't think they're great. Motley needs to be involved.
That game did a lot for me last night with Baylor. I think this team's definitely a Sweet 16 and possibly Elite 8. And, you know, I'm not willing to say they're going to go to a Final Four and compete for an national championship game, but I think they can get to Sweet 16 and possibly Elite 8. I mean, to go into Allen Fieldhouse, man, where they've won 50 in a row.
They lost.
I'm aware, but they didn't lose by 20.
Yeah, but they hit. John's right. They hit a couple bank threes to stay in the game.
Right, they did. But still, they were fighting in the double bonus. I mean, Kansas was in the double bonus in the second half with like 11 minutes left. So, I was impressed with the way they battled last night. And the way that the game was there.
So you think that they're actually...
And they lost it. Granted, okay. That's a tough place to go play.
Yeah.
I mean, hardly anyone goes in there and wins.
That's a great question, Ryan. I will comment on, Kansas has to figure out not only free throw shooting, but they need to figure out what they're doing down low. Because when they face a team that has really good front court, they're going to struggle. I mean, Landon Lucas, and he's your best big? I mean, that's... that's concerning to me.
Yeah.
But they find ways, you know.
Agreed. So. Yeah. Okay, number two. Give me a under-the-radar player that you really like in college basketball.
Marcus Keene. I mean, okay. How is... I mean, he's the most... he's never talked about.
Yeah.
And he's the best scorer in the country. Mm-hmm. If you said to me right now, Jeff, you can pick one player to put him on your team, he'd be my guy.
Okay.
I mean, he can just score. I mean, that's what he does.
That's what he does.
He's a scorer. If you're talking about the bigger conferences... That's fine.
Marcus Keene's fine. I mean, that's
why don't you give yours? Fine. What is yours?
Mine's Ethan Happ for Wisconsin. Happ,
good one.
He doesn't really get talked about hardly at all. I mean, really. I mean, you talk about Wisconsin. You mention him in passing, but you talk about Wisconsin. The first two names you mention are Bronson Canning and Nigel Hayes. So I like Ethan Happ. I mean, he's averaging 15-9 on the year. So and he kind of single handedly won that game for them against. Rutgers, I think it was, where, I mean, no one other than him could score.
Yeah.
I mean, no one's shot was falling. Nigel Hayes didn't have a field goal till overtime. Bronson Canning, I think, had like 8 or 9 points going into overtime. And he just kind of said, you know what? All right, if I'm the guy that's going to have to win this game, that's what it's going to be. So I like Ethan Happ, scrappy kid.
I'll go Melo Trimble. I think he didn't get really ever talked about. Maryland didn't get talked about. We talked about that. I think he can play with anyone.
Okay.
Marcus Keene would... If Marcus Keene played for Kansas, he would ball. He would ball out.
Yeah.
I mean, it doesn't matter where he plays.
Yeah. So.
He's not. So Scott Van Pelt's a lot like you and me and Ryan. Scott Van Pelt knows about, like, little schools. He's all about gambling. If you ask, like.
I think he might be talking about Melo Trimble.
No, he's talking about Keene.
Oh.
Yes. Van Pelt shouted him out on his 50.
Okay. I thought he was talking about Melo Trimble because he's a Maryland guy.
Like, I feel like if you ask, like, Jay Williams about who Marcus Keene was, I don't think he could tell you who he is. Okay. Well, fine. Let's move on.
Third one. What's one food you couldn't live without? Gotta be one. And don't say, well, this, and this. Give me one.
One food.
One food you could not live without.
You go ahead and give yours. I'm going to think about this.
Okay. the funny thing about this question is there's a lot.
Yeah.
I think a lot of people have a lot. I think a lot of people have a lot of foods.
Just one.
Obviously, that they kind of go to and they say, man, I could not live without that.
Yeah.
It's tough. It is tough. Because for me, it's probably chicken parmesan. Like, if they got rid of chicken parmesan...
I could totally live without chicken. I wouldn't mind if that went.
I couldn't do it. That's like my favorite meal of all time. Like soft taco or taco salads right there too. Like okay. You know how much I like tacos. But yeah, that's probably mine. Chocolate's close to it.
I would probably say, I don't know, meatballs.
Meatballs? Okay.
I like meatballs a lot.
Yeah.
You could eat them. You can do different things with them. You could throw them on a sandwich. Mm-hmm. You can eat them, you know.
Right.
I like meatballs a lot. I thought you were kind of looking for more of like just like an ingredient. Or like something quick to eat. People are saying like random. Like chicken, it makes sense.
Yeah.
I could live without chicken.
You can do a lot of
probably ground beef, chicken. I would say. Yeah, ground beef, you make a lot of stuff with.
Mm-hmm.
You know, probably true. That.
Okay.
Nutella. There's a crunchy tacos. I would almost pay to have them go away. I hate tacos.
Yeah. Next one, we have two more. So, four. What are your thoughts on the Pat McAfee situation? If you're not familiar with what happened, Pat McAfee is now the former punter of the Indianapolis Colts. He announced early this morning, late last night, that he's retiring from the game of football. He's had, you know, three surgeries in the last 4 years, and he only predicts more to come. And, you know, he's been around a little bit. And he's actually taking a offer from Barstool Sports and going to join their team now full time. They're going to have a headquarters now in Indianapolis. They asked him to move to New York. He said no. They said okay. They came back then later on and said, hey, what if we give you an office and a headquarters in Indianapolis? Would you take our offer? And he said yes. So he is now retiring from football and pursuing his media with Barstool Sports.
Yeah, I'm not sure that's a story. I mean, big deal. Good for him, you know.
Yeah.
It's not, he's been in the league for a long time, hasn't he?
He's
got a pension.
I'm not sure exactly. Apparently, he's leaving I forget how many millions of dollars on the table. And he's actually going to have to, I believe he's going to actually have to pay the Colts now a certain amount of money, I think.
Okay.
Certain millions of dollars now.
I guess he's just probably, you know, sick of the grind, traveling and all that kind of stuff. I mean, yeah. He does have a tough job. I mean, he's a punter. You know, sure. It's not a tough job, right. But... yeah, I mean, he wants to go do something he likes to do. I don't have a problem with that. I mean, it's no different from, you know, going to be is he any different from Teddy Bruschi? Or,
well, here's the thing, too, and
29's old.
This is kind of becoming the norm is people retiring at an early age. So I don't really bat an eye at it. I read it this morning and I was like, oh wow, he's retiring. Oh wow, he's going to work for Barstool Sports. Sweet, good for him.
I mean, I think it's
kind of the way I look at it.
I think it's sad for, like, some of these guys that, like, they can't play anymore.
Yeah.
You know, because of, like, injuries and right. things like that.
Some people are just retiring early just for health, just so they don't get to that point.
Right. Yeah, I don't have a problem with Pat McAfee leaving. That. Good for him. You know, he's been in the league since, you know, 2009? I mean, he's been in the league for
He's a pretty entertaining guy. He does a lot of antics and stuff, so that'll obviously be missed, but... last question, Jeff. Today's Groundhog Day, and if you've seen the movie Groundhog Day with Bill Murray, you go back, you relive a day, he relives the same day over and over again. If you can go back and relive one sports moment...
By the way, Ryan, Pat McAfee makes $5 million a year, so not really too concerned with his well-being going forward.
If you could go back and relive one sports moment in your life, what would it be?
The Sixers run in 2000.
Which day? Because it can only be one day. Which game? Game one of the finals, probably.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Probably. I think that was the greatest game I've ever seen as a fan, just because it was fantastic.
Yeah.
That whole year was great, though.
It was fun.
I mean, just every game, you know.
Yeah.
It was just awesome, and I loved AI. So.
Right. Yeah, it's tough for me because I would either pick the 08 World Series clincher or the NFC Championship game for the Eagles. And I think I'll pick, and it might sound crazy, but I'm going to pick the Eagles Championship game. I'm going to pass up a World Championship.
You mean the Super Bowl or the...
No, the Championship game against Atlanta. I would not want to go back to the Super Bowl. Absolutely not.
It's a cool thing, though.
Nah, they lost. I mean, come on. If they won, of course, it'd be different. But, yeah, the NFC, just for the fact they lost the previous 3 years to finally get over the hump and... It was a real special day. That was cool. I remember I didn't even go to school the next day. I was home with my dad celebrating, which is pretty cool. So that's what I would go back to is the NFC Championship game. The Eagles in 2004 when they beat the Falcons.
Yeah, that's a good one. Christian Laettner making that shot in Kentucky. You were alive for that?
It wasn't that long ago.
It was in like the 80s, wasn't it?
Yeah, he seems like an older guy, the best gambler. Just saying.
That's not very nice, Ryan.
Why is that not nice?
I think he's pretty young.
We're 27. I would bet a lot of money that he's in his 30s.
Oh, in his 30s?
Mid to late 30s.
But, like, he would
and
be
that's another. And that's another 12, that's another, what, 10 years? If mid-30s, if he's 37, that's 10 years. I mean, when was the Laettner shot? That wasn't that
long. It was, like, 91, maybe.
That was early 90s. So.
Oh, you were 11 years old.
Okay. He was 11, he remembers. Cool. Yeah, there you go.
Giant Super Bowl catch, yeah, I mean, that will never happen again.
that was crazy.
Ever. Ryan, what's your play of the day?
Elon minus 7.
Very good. For me, the strongest free plays that I would give out would be over 182 Citadel, and I also would give out, yeah, I like Memphis at 13. At 15, it's getting up there a little bit. So I would definitely like those two. You know. There's some other ones for sure. Feel free to listen back to the show and hear all that. We'll be back Monday with another edition of the Big Men on Campus. I don't know. It depends on how big the card is tomorrow. Maybe we'll do a quick show. I don't know. We'll also, though, be back Monday where we'll relive the Super Bowl. We'll relive all the things that went on, the props, and break down Monday's card as well. Everyone have a great night. Feel free to reach out to me on Twitter, at Jeff, JeffNadu, if you have anything you want to talk to me about. You can also reach Ryan at DIA18. Everyone have a great night. We'll see you later. Bye-bye.